Hello, and welcome back to Coin Lady Channel. The XRP community has a long-standing mythology that a major cyber assault will be utilized to introduce the new financial system, thereby mandating that all financial institutions adopt it. In a strange turn of events, we are seeing a meteoric rise in cyber attacks aimed at some of the world's top corporations. In light of a recent interview with a Ripple supporting bank, I'd want to speculate on the implications of this development for XRP and Ripple. He explains that he joined the network to safeguard his investments against the SWIFT system. In this video, I'll examine whether or not Ripple and XRP offer a workable solution to the pervasive cyberattacks that have recently emerged. Don't leave early, since you won't want to miss a thing. After the credits roll, stay for the discussion of the recent interview we conducted with Brad Garlinghouse. As I indicated at the opening of the video, there are a ton of cyber attacks taking place all around the world at the moment. And these aren't just little cyber attacks either. Earlier morning, we noticed that a major hack had taken down the entire Federal Reserve security system. One of China's largest banks was also the victim of a hack. The overall treasury market may have also been affected by this cyber attack. Those of you who keep up with the treasury market know that it is currently the most important market in the world, so this is absolutely bonkers. Thus, with all these stories that were kind of floating throughout the XRP community, cyber warfare actually pulling down the entire financial system, the prospect that cyber attackers or cyber thieves could bring down the entire treasury market is extremely concerning. The cornerstone of the present traditional financial system is pretty dated technology, therefore it's possible that this is the case if they manage to shut down one of the world's largest marketplaces. They don't want to release them to the public out of fear of upsetting the peace. Even though there are definitely a lot more cyber attacks than we know about happening every single day all across the world, since our existing financial system is built on such highly dated information, fraudsters may find it quite simple to take advantage of it. Since more and more cyber criminals have access to cutting-edge tools like AI capable of quickly bringing down these systems, I fear the escalation of cyber warfare. I've already mentioned that these crooks can get their hands on cutting-edge gadgets much sooner than official establishments. The large businesses must go through all of these procedures in order to update and modify information. They are obliged to take all of these formal examinations, to educate their staff to use the new systems, and must go through all of these separate processes. Numerous approvals from regulatory agencies are needed to improve and implement the systems. However, hackers couldn't care less. They aren't constrained by the same bureaucracy that huge enterprises face, and can instead focus on developing and releasing new malware specifically designed to compromise these systems. That's why they're always a step ahead of the game, and why I blame the rise of AI for the recent surge in cyber attacks on major corporations. In light of this problem with our current banking system, I will now describe XRP and Ripple as a transition to the reality that XRP is a solution to this problem. And yeah, I believe the response to that is, however, I want to quickly explain to you that institutions are already fully aware of this before we go into that. In fact, the CTO of CIMB Bank is speaking the same topic here. In fact, nowadays, more people utilize SWIFT than any other payment system. However, given the radical differences between the present and the future, we must also ensure that fallback plans are in place. While we had a banking system that was virtually impenetrable for decades, criminals just needed a few simple tools to bring it down. But even that is changing rapidly. You're about to find out why it's more important than ever to diversify your strategies and avoid relying too much on any one approach. Please hear me out. Within the context of marketing, in order to spread the risk, I have separated my clientele. Since you used SWIFT, I'll assume you used the most recent version, and I think this will continue for a while. True, you also have more modern networks like Ripple and others. Since nothing else of any real importance needs to be mentioned, it's also rather interesting. He paused there. It wasn't always the case, however, and he makes it clear right off the bat that you need to hedge, or ensure that you were exposed to other networks. But by making that one declaration, the old world's methods have been radically altered. You can stop worrying about SWIFT now that you've used it. there was no lack of necessities. However, in the world we will soon enter, the stability of such structures will be greatly reduced. Therefore, you should be sure to provide your customers with more alternatives. It's also interesting to note that whenever a new system or rival to SWIFT is brought up in conversation, talk of Ripple and XRP inevitably follows. SWIFT, XRP, and Ripple look to be the most direct competitors. In addition, we are well aware of its superiority. If SWIFT doesn't come up with a compromise, SWIFT will never be able to match what XRP accomplishes for the Ripple network. The subject of whether XRP actually affected the intrusions has been raised, and I believe it does. The current financial system architecture has a major flaw due to its centralization. Finding and exploiting a single entry point into a system can cause its complete collapse. And the system collapses as a whole the moment one component falls down. It seems like a stack of Jenga blocks, and prodding it doesn't seem to do anything. Cryptocurrencies, on the other hand, are vulnerable to a whole collapse if even a single vulnerability is exploited, due to their decentralized and distributed design. There is something that can't be shut down, and that's the XRP network. If it were possible, it would have been finished by now. So that's why Bitcoin has been around for so long. This explains XRP's remarkable longevity. This is due to the fact that these networks are dispersed and decentralized. They last for a very long time. It's important to remember how easy it would be for hackers to exploit even a single SWIFT network flaw. They need just zero in on a single topic of study to breeze through it with ease. To bring down the XRP ledger, however, you must focus on the hundreds of validators that are spread out around the globe, which is 10 times more difficult than the existing system. Furthermore, as I indicated at the beginning of the film, these systems require modernization since they offer security that our conventional banking system now lacks. Our monetary system is currently supported by outmoded technology. To attack these networks and substantially compromise them in ways never seen before, hackers today have access to more potent tools than ever before. To fix this, we need to upgrade our infrastructure. The plan is to build our financial system on brand new, advanced rails that will make it impossible for fraudsters to launch a successful attack. Therefore, I think bank CEOs around the world are contemplating the need to attempt to adopt new technologies to hedge their bets against the SWIFT system, which will be more resilient in the future world we live. To conclude up this video, I'd like to show you a brief excerpt from today's speech by Brad Garlinghouse. This is unrelated to the topic at hand. But, as I always stress, I believe it is vital that we listen when Brad Garlinghouse speaks. When major names like David Schwartz and Stuart Alderotti start talking, ripples form, therefore let's wrap up this film in Dubai. After the first ever Swell conference hosted by Ripple wrapped up, I got the opportunity to speak with Brad Garlinghouse, the company's CEO. Pay attention, Ripple has defeated the SEC 3 times in a row, and I asked about it on stage when they were discussing their legal battle with the Securities and Exchange Commission over the status of their XRP token. To begin, the verdict on July 13 made it crystal clear that XRP is not a security. Second, the court ruled against their request for an interlocutory appeal. Finally, there was the blatantly biased firing. The allegations that have been made against Chris Larson and me. Doing something over and over again with the expectation of a different outcome is often cited as a definition of insanity. The SEC keeps doing the same thing over and over again, probably hoping for a different outcome this time. As we've discussed behind the scenes, the Bitcoin ETF eventually prevailed in a major victory in the United States, with a federal judge citing the SEC as a federal agency and quoting the SEC as saying that it was acting arbitrarily and capriciously. You probably already know that judges try to stay out of the spotlight and keep a level head. Those are some rather severe accusations. As a result, I think the SEC will have to pause and admit that the regulatory approach it has taken thus far, predicated on a focus on enforcement, has not been effective. The cycle of let's just sue each other must end. So in this scenario, walk me through the next steps. Today was the last day to submit a proposed timeline for remedy briefings. The SEC is requesting about $770 million in disgorgement. So, what happens next? In yesterday's Washington, D.C. session, I joked about wanting to see the best odds and viable solutions to the case. It seems to me that the SEC's original mission of protecting investors has been forgotten. And here in the garden, where we're going as it is, the judge or the court will decide on any possible remedies. That's exactly what we needed to hear. In this case, I think it's vital to think about how the investors were impacted, as well as how the securities rules work and whether or not there are any exemptions for institutional and accredited investors. But allow me to say this. I believe that the SEC has oversight in the US is a good thing for the sector as a whole, not just Ripple, Chris, and Brad, and hoping that this will help to kind of defrost the permafrost in the US so that we can witness the growth of an incredible business with enormous potential and the world's largest economy. It's all over today. Please like and subscribe my channel. See you later, bye.